isn't a call to action. It is a call to action. And please think about...
One of the founding architects of the Young African Leaders Initiative, Chris Runyon, sheds more light on the program.
Even in this sub-region, we are a 14-country family.
We know that this has been a priority now for the United States government for a few years. What is the perspective or the assessment of the United States government about the role that this program can play, not just in positioning African leaders individually, but also positioning Africa in the global community?
One thing I would say is about YALI. There is an architecture of it, and sort of three main components. So the Mandela Washington Fellowship, which a lot of people are familiar with, which is a wonderful part of the program where we bring people to the United States for training and then provide them support, be that mentoring or coaching or practicum opportunities in companies or in organizations, is one component of that. Another is the YALI Regional Leadership Centers, which was bringing YALI to Africa and establishing places where this same type of inspired training could take place here in Africa to a much larger group of people for a lower cost per person, and was really a result of the kind of response that we had for the Mandela Washington Fellowship when it was first conceptualized. And then the third I'd cite is the YALI network, which is predominantly a virtual network, but is growing increasingly into a network that also gets together in person in Africa. And that includes hundreds of thousands of young African leaders who are making change in their communities, but may not necessarily have the ability or the time to participate in either the Mandela Washington Fellowship or to be able to take weeks off of work to be able to come to a regional leadership center training program. So those are three parts of the program I just want folks to understand. But to your strategic question, what's the relationship here and why? I think the most important part is Africa is dramatically important to the world. It is an amazing place of diversity, of resources, of talent, of potential. And the world wants to interact with Africa. And I think that was really an engine behind creating these programs in the first place. And YALI is an umbrella set of programs that includes all those pieces I just mentioned. So the engine behind it was a desire to really deepen the relationship between the United States and the U.S. people to young leaders. And this dynamic, amazing generation of young leaders, who, of course, because of mathematics, will be the leaders of the future, but they're also leaders of today. And if the United States could play a role in helping to turbo boost them or provide extra skills that might not be as easily or readily available in African contexts, we wanted that opportunity. We obviously want to be able to demonstrate the fact that new trade relationships, new business relationships, new partnerships, intellectual or otherwise, are created between American citizens and young African leaders through this program. And there are stories like that, which show that a business has partnered with a company in the United States as a result of the fact that somebody went to the University of Wisconsin in Stout, or at the University of Delaware, or something like that. So when the fellows come to the United States in particular, they have really unique opportunities to engage with the American private sector. And so I think that's one piece. The other I would cite is even in non-business relationships, but in nonprofit organization relationships, I'm aware of several examples of cases where fellows have come to the United States. Through their program, they've met people and networked with companies and organizations in the United States, nonprofits, community organizations. They've picked up techniques and ideas and suggestions, and similarly, they've left ideas and suggestions for American organizations to use. I'm very proud of the fact that major U.S. universities and colleges in the United States have seen how YALI worked with the Mandela Washington Fellowship and the great experiences that a lot of young leaders had in the United States, and they said, well, this can't end with that. We want to scale this up, and we want to do more, and we want to help do it in Africa. So we've received a lot of inquiries, and we've had specific activities that have taken place here because U.S. universities and U.S. organizations and U.S. companies have said, how do we become part of the regional leadership centers? One example, Dartmouth College had trained in business and entrepreneurship in the United States for Mandela Washington Fellows and was so fascinated with their experience that they galvanized a team of professors and staff to come here to Nairobi. And they've been coming here training in business and entrepreneurship skills and in design thinking, which is a really innovative, challenging way to think differently about your problems and your issues in order to make a venture successful. There is a lively, prosperous, amazing Africa that many people don't know. And I would certainly encourage more of the world to better understand that Africa.
Mr. Runyon, we know that much of the leadership crises, particularly in the African continent, have to do with stagnant leadership, leadership that perhaps lacks vision. And one of the questions I wanted to ask you is, when we talk about young African leaders, this YALI initiative, why is the United States so keenly interested in investing in young African leaders as opposed to just maybe African leaders of all ages?
Yeah, thanks for the question, Ajuri. I think as we've seen, in some cases, Africa's potential is held back by some of its leaders. And that lack of inclusion of young people, that lack of representation of their interests, really creates a disconnect between the state and the people. And that doesn't help us all achieve the kind of progress and potential that Africa holds for itself and for the world. It hinders progress in political rights, in human rights. It hinders the ability for Africa's economies to grow with regressive policies. And it certainly doesn't help to create the Africa that we all know exists, the one of entrepreneurship, the one of energy, the one of engagement, the one that loves to learn and engage with the world and share its amazing lessons. And so closed societies or societies that prevent that voice from getting out are things, obviously, that the United States doesn't want to see continue. This generation of young Africans offers an opportunity to engage with a fearless, energetic, creative demographic that is intent on making the type of change that they see and that they envision for Africa. And so the role that the United States can play, even a small role, as part of their journey to leading this continent, we want to play that role.
As the regional summit concludes, he answers a question on the minds of young leaders.
I've had the privilege of going into the communities of some of these young African leaders, and I have seen firsthand the impact, the intellect, the drive, the passion of some of these young people in impacting their communities. And one of the questions that arises is, how does the United States government, how does the program work in such a way that these young people can utilize their passion, their intellect, and all of their intangibles to be able to break in to positions of authority in both the public sector and private sector at a leadership level, given this very troublesome trend of youth exclusion across the continent?
Yeah. Well, I think great question and a complex one. But I would say, first of all, I think increasingly there are global standards of youth engagement and youth inclusion. There is a recognition globally that if you leave youth out of decisions, it's going to result in bad policy and bad outcomes, both for government, for the economy, and for the young people themselves. That doesn't mean this is still going to be easy. This is going to be challenging. It's going to be very hard. And I tell you, many of the successes that our young leaders that we've been able to work with through YALI face a lot of challenges when they come back, especially the Mandela Fellows who go to the United States. Many of them return extremely energized by what they've experienced in the U.S., and their minds swimming with the tools that they've acquired that they want to apply in the African context. But sometimes they hit a wall. They hit a wall that doesn't allow them to engage, or they hit challenges of corruption, or nepotism, or closed systems that they have no access to. And it's very discouraging for them. The most important ingredient, the anecdote in many cases to those problems, is not just the burning fire within some of these young leaders who have made a lifetime commitment to make positive change, but I would argue it's the safety net. And that is the network of people who they build relationships with, both through the program and then beyond the program. So I think for anything like what we're trying to do or other types of youth empowerment and youth engagement programs, you need to have a strategic approach. You need to have a long-term view, and you need to stick with your plans. And then you need to make sure that the enabling factors around that young leader who may be struggling with these issues like we've talked about is able to overcome fear, is able to overcome setbacks, is able to ask for help, and is able to feel like they're part of a bigger movement.
It was absolutely eye-opening to hear of the different accounts of young people who drove change in their communities, often in the face of repression and other various forms of systemic inertia. Furthermore, I come away with a better understanding of how important it is to stay encouraged, motivated, and determined, even when it appears that your efforts are failing or that your efforts are not being recognized. Many of the YALI Network alum were denied before they gained access. When we strive and refuse to yield to frustration, success is inevitable. My name is Ajuri Ngelale. Until next time, lead where you are, and followers will find you.